Hello viewers, happy to meet you all again. I welcome you all on behalf of Indian Medical College. And today, session 3, we are going to have a wonderful topic, Salmonella infections, and Dr. Ajit Vijayan will be delivering this talk. Sir is from Pushpagiri Institute of Medical Sciences. If you are having any doubts, you can use the chat section. The live chat section is enabled. Please type your chats. Sir will be answering all your doubts at the end of the session. And please know that this is a pre-recorded video and we are going to play the video now.
Friends, welcome to my class on Introduction of Mycology. In today's class, I will be giving you a very brief overview of the way in which fungi are classified and also a very brief overview on the different types of infections that it causes and the techniques that we employ in a mycology laboratory to identify and diagnose these fungal infections. Mycology has originated from the term mycs, which means mushroom. It is basically a study of the epidemiology, the ecology, pathogenesis, diagnosis, and the treatment modalities of fungal infections in human beings. Basically, fungi are widely distributed in nature. That is what we need to understand upfront. Now, if you roughly take a guess of how many fungi are present, you will know that there are more than 1.5 crores of fungi which are usually present. And out of this innumerable number of fungi which are distributed widely in nature, 70,000 of them have been clearly documented with their morphological forms and the diagnostic techniques. Out of the 70,000 fungal species, 400 of them are usually known to cause human infections. Out of these 400 fungal species known to cause human infections, 100 of them are commonly seen in our routine clinical practice. And out of these 100 fungi, 50 fungi are noted with increasing frequency among the patients that usually come to our hospital settings. Now, if I have to summarize this entire class in one word, that would be to define the fungi. Now, if you look at the definition of fungi, this is an apt definition, not because it is a lengthy one, but because it covers the different aspects of fungi. So if you can see, we usually define fungi as achlorophyllous, that means it doesn't contain chlorophyll. Eukaryotic, so it contains all the cellular organelles. Heterotrophic, depending on the different sources for sunlight and energy. Unicellular or multicellular organism, which have a wide growth requirement. They can be facultatively anaerobic or strictly aerobic, and multiply sexually and asexually, and exist as saprotrophs in the environment and also in the dead and decaying organic debris. Commensals, they form a part of our normal flora, or parasites, causing a range of infections from superficial, subcutaneous, deep and disseminated infections. So this in a nutshell covers the entire spectrum of the characteristics of a fungi. So I will repeat the definition once again. Fungi are achlorophyllous, eukaryotic, heterotrophic, unicellular or multicellular organisms which are facultatively anaerobic or strictly aerobic and multiply sexually and asexually, existing as saprotrophs, commensals or parasites, causing superficial, subcutaneous, deep and disseminated infections. Now, if you look at the discovery pyramid of microorganisms, you will notice that out of all the different type of microbes that we know, the viruses, parasites, bacteria and fungi, the latest or the last to be discovered are the viruses in the year 1892. Before viruses, we knew bacteria in the year 1676 thanks to Anton van Leeuwenhoek's microscope. Prior to the bacteria, the incidence of parasitic infections were detected in the Ebers papyrus in Egypt, and even prior to the parasites, which were detected in 1500 BC, fungi were known to be a part of 2.4 billion year old fossils in South Africa. So the point that I'm trying to make here is, fungi are the oldest of all the different microbes that are usually present. But when we come to clinical practice, when usually we are asked about the probable infectious causes of one condition in our clinical practice, we generally start with bacterial, viral, parasitic, and then only come to the fungal infections. Probably this is the reason why the epidemiology of fungal infections have not been studied well. Probably this is also the reason why fungal infections have been underdiagnosed in clinical practice. So this particular juncture, I would like to tell all of you that whenever we encounter an infectious person or a patient with an infectious etiology, we should always have a very broad mind to include bacteria, virus, parasites and fungi in equal measures. Okay, the priority should be equal. You should not look for a fungal infection after you have ruled out bacterial, viral and parasitic infections. So all of them, the fungal infections should be on par with the other microbial infections. So such a high index of suspicion will usually enable you to pick up the fungal infections quite early, and if it is diagnosed and treated early, the patients recover quite early. And you will also be become a very good clinician if you are able to pick up such infections. And I personally believe that there is a huge pool of undetected cases of fungal infections in India. Now, whenever we talk of the identification of fungi, we usually quote John Rippon, who usually remarks that the identification of fungi is often like the problem of being able to recognize your own grandmother among the residents of a nursing home for the elderly. You can pick her out in a crowd, but no one else can, even when given her description. Now, my friends, this is because we are not aware of the lingo or the language that is used to describe the fungi. One thing that we always should remember is, unlike all the other microbes where the variation is much more lesser, the fungi or the variations in a fungal isolate is quite frequent. So the only constant in mycology is variation. And with the rapid advancement of the diagnostic techniques, especially the molecular diagnostic tools, the fungal classification has been altered very frequently, and even the names of the fungi have changed. So if you consider the basic differences between a fungi and the bacteria, one thing which stands out is that fungi are primarily eukaryotic, okay? And the second thing that we all should remember is that fungi contains ergosterol, which is not present in the bacteria. Another thing is the cell wall of the fungi usually is composed of chitin, glucan and mannan. Now, why am I emphasizing about the ergosterol and the chitin, glucan and mannan is that most of our antifungals which are currently available to treat these infections target the ergosterol and the glucan pathway synthesis. And also some of the serological tests of the fungal for fungi usually employ antibodies directed against glucan and mannan. So therefore it is very vital for us to remember these three differences. So this is the reason why I told that we need to remember about these cellular components. If you look at the azole group of antifungals which are widely used to treat the fungal infection, they primarily inhibit the ergosterol biosynthesis pathway. Now another class of antibiotics, that is your polyenes, okay, even the polyenes primarily act on the ergosterol pathway and disrupts the membrane integrity. So your common polyene that is used is amphotericin B, which is usually employed for the detection of the fungal for treatment of fungal infections in the immunocompromised patients. And the newer drugs like your echinocandins, caspofungin, micafungin and anidulafungin inhibit the glucan synthesis. And there are also other drugs like flurcytosine which inhibits nucleic acid synthesis. So your frontline antifungal drugs, your azoles, candens and amphotericin B primarily act on ergosterol and glucan biosynthesis pathways. So the other differences are that fungi can reproduce both sexually and asexually. If you do a gram staining on the fungi, usually they are gram positive and they are non-acid fast, and we employ the histochemical stains or histopathological stains like periodic acid shift stain and gomori methylamine silver stain to also detect the fungal hyphae, especially in the tissues. So as I told you, my friends, when I studied MBBS, I usually was taught that fungi usually cause infections only in the immunocompromised. Now in the year 2020, we have noted certain drastic changes in the epidemiological determinants in causing fungal infections. The mere presence of an indwelling device and the increased environmental spore burden itself is a high risk factor for a fungal infection even in immunocompetent hosts. So that's what I would like to highlight. Most of the fungal infections are now seen in immunocompetent individuals. In our own mycology laboratory, we have noticed that over the past 3 to 4 years, more and more fungal infections have been detected among the age group of 40 to 60 years rather than greater than 60 years of age patient population. So we have an increasing number of fungal infections seen in immunocompetent individuals and seen in the most economically productive age group population. Also, mere admission to the intensive care unit along with other comorbidities like kidney diseases and liver diseases and lung diseases along with diabetes mellitus is also another very important risk factor for fungal infection. Definitely, climate change has played a major role in the increased incidence of fungal infections. We earlier speak of yeast growing at 37 degrees Celsius and molds growing at 28 degrees Celsius whenever we talk of fungal infections. But now we are also seeing that some of the molds grow at 37 degrees Celsius. So the climatic changes have enabled these fungi to adapt itself to the variations and cause infections. More and more fungal infections are seen among economically deprived patients who do not have enough resources or money to get treated, and therefore they go towards quacks who employ unscientific methods. Definitely, abuse and misuse of antibiotics and steroids have led to an alarming rate of fungal infections among the common population. So what these antibiotics do or the steroids do is they interfere with the immunoregulatory and immunomodulatory functions in our host, and they destroy the resident microbial flora in the humans. So this will predispose the causation of fungal infections, especially the commensal fungal infections. And as of today, there is no one hospital in our Indian subcontinent where the construction activities don't take place. So every construction activity in the hospital is associated generation of lot of dust and other particles which contain lot of these fungal spores in the environment. So your spore burden in the environment is drastically increased. So therefore, before proceeding to construct the or renovate the hospital premises, it is always worthwhile to consider the type of patients who are present in that particular area of hospital where you would like to do these construction activities, and you would like to isolate them or shift them from these constructive activities so that they are at lesser risk of the inhalation of the environmental spores which are generated due to the rampant hospital construction activities. So now we come to the different cell wall components of the fungi. This picture or this diagram is of the negative staining or the India ink staining of yeast, which is called as Cryptococcus neoformans. So the halo that you are seeing against a dark background represents the capsule of the fungi. Now, capsule of a fungi is usually made of extracellular polysaccharide. It is a determinant of virulence and elicits the host immune response. Again, presence of capsule is one of the basis of certain diagnostic tests. Then we come to the next important cellular organelle. As I told you, we have your chitin, glucan and mannan, which basically maintains shape and protects the fungi from the adverse effects of the environment. The cell wall is also responsible for providing nutrition to the fungi, and the antibodies directed against these cell wall components are employed in the serological test and are also the sites of action of the antifungal drugs. So the other organelles present in the fungi, I will just quickly mention, because you all know that fungi are eukaryotic and you know the various cellular organelles. So here we have the nucleus, which contains or which is limited by the nuclear membrane. Then the chromosomes present inside the nucleus. We have the plasma membrane delimiting the cytoplasm from the cell wall. Then we have the cytoplasm with its various organelles like the Golgi apparatus and the mitochondria. So all of these cellular organelles are present in the fungi because fungi are eukaryotic in nature. Now, one of the basic essential points that you need to consider or remember whenever we talk about fungi is the different structures which are present in the fungi. Fungal hyphae are the preliminary structures which are present in the fungi. So the fungi consist of simpler units or basic structures called as hyphae, and these hyphae are filamentous structures composed of chitin. They are multinucleate and they usually grow at the tips. So the presence of the hyphae enables fungi to establish itself into the host, and it using this hyphae, the fungi invades into the different tissues and gathers nutrition from the surroundings. Based on the presence or absence of the septa, the hyphae are classified into a septate hyphae and a non-septate hyphae. We also have several shapes described with the hyphae. They are usually described as racket hyphae, nodular hyphae, spiral hyphae, or root-like hyphae, depending on the different fungal species. Now, usually racket, nodular, and spiral hyphae are associated with a group of fungi which are called as dermatophytes, which primarily cause infections of the keratinized tissues of the body like your hair, skin, and nail. Whereas rhizoids, as you all must be aware from your biology classes, is usually a very important hyphal structure or a component of fungi such as rhizopus and mucor, which usually contaminates the foodstuff. Both rhizopus and mucor also belong to a very important class of fungi called as zygomycetes, about which we will be seeing later. So these individual units are called as hyphae, and when you have a group of hyphae, we call it as a mycelium. So this is what is called as the mycelium, and you would have noticed the mycelium usually seen contaminating the foodstuff, okay, your old foodstuff. And also you might be seeing this mycelium in certain old furniture, okay, in old books, old furniture, or during the rainy season, especially in the clothes, in the wet clothes, you might be seeing some mycelium like this. So this is a septate hyphae because of the presence of the characteristic septa, and this is aseptate or non-septate hyphae because if you see the entire structure, there are no septa. Okay, the aseptate hyphae are also called as coenocytic hyphae. Okay, coenocytic, coenocytic hyphae. Now we come to the fungal spores. Now, unlike bacterial spores, which are usually formed under adverse environmental conditions, fungal spores are usually formed as a result of a reproduction taking place in the fungi. Now, when there is a sexual reproduction taking place, we usually have different sexual spores depending on the class of the fungi. Whereas whenever asexual reproduction takes place, we call the spores as conidia. So please remember, when we say spores, we mean that these are the propagules of sexual reproduction of fungi, And when we say conidia, we mean that they are the propagules of asexual reproduction of the fungi. Now your conidia, depending on the size, you can further identify it as a microconidia or a macroconidia. Micro means small and macro means large. So what you are seeing here are the spores, okay, the different spores which are released from the fruiting bodies here, okay, which are called as phyllids. These spores are released in chains. So this is the spore of a fungi called as Penicillium, and now Penicillium has been renamed as Talaromyces. So please remember, the genus Penicillium or Penicillium marnefi, which we usually studied in the science classes, has now been renamed as Talaromyces marnefi or Talaromyces species. And what you're seeing here, okay, is of the both the microconidia and macroconidia of a common fungal species which are called as dermatophytes. Okay, so this particular dermatophyte is a fungi called as Trichophyton rubrum. Okay, here you can see numerous microconidia, and along with that you can see some pencil shaped macroconidia here. Okay, usually this typical appearance is described as bird on wire appearance. So now we come to the morphological classification of the fungi. Based on their appearances, fungi are morphologically classified into several categories. Now the first morphological classification is called as the yeast. Now the yeast are a class of fungi which are usually unicellular in nature. Microscopically, they appear oval to round and they reproduce by budding. So usually yeast appear as oval to round cells with budding. Okay, so this is the typical budding which is seen in a yeast cell. So every yeast cell will undergo this budding and they reproduce by budding. So this particular cell, the daughter cell which is formed by the budding, is usually formed, this formation usually takes place by utilizing all the layers of the cell present in the parent yeast. So therefore this is budding yeast cells are also called as the blastoconidia. Okay, please remember, in some of the textbooks you will find it as blastoconidia. So don't get confused. Blastoconidia are the budding yeast cells because they employ all the layers of the cell wall of the parent cell. Macroscopically, they resemble bacterial colonies and they are usually pasty in nature. And a common example of the yeast is your Cryptococcus neoformans, which causes meningitis in immunocompromised individuals, especially in HIV positive immunocompromised individuals. However, there are varieties of cryptococci which can also cause infections in immunocompetent individuals. Now the next class of the microbes is called as the yeast like group. Now the yeast like micro fungi or the yeast like group of fungi grow partly as yeast and partly as elongated cells resembling hyphae. So these are called as pseudo hyphae. Now here I would like to stress upon the differences between a hyphae and a pseudo hyphae. Hyphae usually are elongated structures which have parallel walls and there are no constrictions across the entire length of the hyphae. But if you see a pseudo hyphae, as it is shown here, pseudo hyphae the cell walls are not parallel, they are opposed to each other or they are pinched, and as they grow or as they arise from the parent yeast cell, there is a small constriction in the parent yeast cell, okay, from the parent yeast cell wall. So the pseudo hyphae or the false hyphae, which is usually described in Candida albicans, is nothing but a hyphal structure which has a constriction at the point of origin, whereas a true hyphae will never have this constriction. A common example of yeast-like organism, as I told you, is your commensal fungi, Candida albicans, which is usually seen as your commensal fungi in your oral respiratory tract and also in the reproductive tract. Now, the next class of fungi are usually described as molds. Now, molds, in comparison to yeast, molds are multicellular and they are seen both as hyphae and they also have spores or conidia depending on the type of the reproduction process, and usually they appear pigmented macroscopically. The colonies appear pigmented, so different types of pigments are present in different molds, and sometimes we use this pigmentation characteristics to identify certain species of molds. So if you look at the colony of a mold, the side of the colony that is facing you directly, it is called as the obverse side, and the side of the colony which is facing against you or which is opposite to you is called as the reverse side. So we are using several terms to describe the topography of the colonies, and most of the time you will find descriptions like cottony, woolly, velvety or granular described for molds. So some of the most common molds are dermatophytes and your aspergillus species. So what you are seeing in this diagram is a mold. This is the macroconidia and this is the hyphae, the spiral hyphae. This is the boat shaped macroconidia, and this particular isolate belongs to a fungi, a dermatophytic fungi called Trichophyton mantegrophytes. The next class of the fungi are called as the dimorphic fungi. Now, why they are called dimorphic is because they are capable of existing under different morphological forms depending on the environmental conditions. Usually at 37 degrees Celsius or in vivo or inside the human body, they exist as yeast, and at 25 degrees Celsius in vitro, they exist as molds. Some of the examples of dimorphic fungi are Histoplasma capsulatum, Blastomyces dermatitis, Coccidioides immitis, Sporothrix schenkii. Now, what we need to remember here is that we need to demonstrate the conversion of the yeast form to the mold form whenever we identify the dimorphic fungi. So this particular conversion is, demonstration of this conversion is a must to identify the dimorphic fungi. So this is your morphological classification of fungi. Now we slowly move over to the spore-based classification of the fungi. So morphologically they are classified as yeast, yeast-like, mold and dimorphic. Now based on spore formation, we classify fungi further as Zygomycota, Basidiomycota and Ascomycota. Now, Zygomycota are your conjugation fungi, and usually these type of fungi have aseptate hyphae. Okay, the characteristic presence of broad aseptate hyphae is the hallmark of the zygomycetes fungi. As per the current classification, the zygomycetes have been renamed as glomerulomycota. Okay, I will repeat once again. As per the current classification, zygomycetes have been renamed as glomerulomycota. Now, zygomycetes classically produce zygospores in the sexual stage, and in the asexual stage, the sac called as sporangium contains numerous sporangiospores. So the sexual spores are zygospores and the asexual spores are sporangiospores present within a sac called as sporangia. The two hallmark characteristics of any zygomycetes infection is that, number one, they are very rapidly angio-invasive. That means they invade the blood vessels so fast that if at all there is a fungal emergency, it is because of the zygomycetes which cause the fungal infection. So any suspected zygomycete infections, we quickly go for the surgical debridement or in some cases surgical amputation of the affected part to prevent these fungi from rapidly invading to the other parts of the body. The second hallmark is usually the zygomycetes fungi cause infections in the diabetic patients. Okay, that is because the diabetic patients, especially those who are in the stage of diabetic ketoacidosis, have high level of ketone bodies in their system. So these zygomycetes fungi utilize the ketone reductase system to metabolize these ketone bodies and utilize the ketone bodies for their growth and reproduction and metabolism and further invasion. So these are the two hallmarks of the zygomycetes fungi. Now if you ask me who are the members, I've already mentioned they are your rhizopus, mucor, and commonly they are seen contaminating your foodstuffs, especially if you keep some foodstuffs for a long time in the fridge, you will notice that some of the foodstuffs are usually contaminated by the zygomycetes fungi. But having said that, please also remember that sometimes even Aspergillus or Penicillium species can also contaminate these foodstuffs. So then we have your Ascomycota. As I mentioned about Aspergillus previously, now Ascomycota, Aspergillus is the classical example of the Ascomycetes fungi. In comparison to the Zygomycetes fungi, the Ascomycota have a septate hyphae. So that is the basic difference structurally. So Zygomycota have broad aseptate hyphae. Sometimes some of the zygomycetes also have sparsely septate hyphae. So but the proportion of both this presence or absence of the septa is relatively variable. So the generally they have more number of aseptate hyphae than the septate hyphae. Whereas in contrast to your zygomycetes, your ascomycetes usually have septate hyphae. They are described as cup fungi. The sexual spores are called as ascospores, usually present within a sac or ascus, and the asexual spores usually are seen at the tip of the hyphae. So classical example of the ascospores are shown in this particular diagram, and this is the cluster of asci. These are the ascospores which are usually seen in Aspergillus species. Now the next class of fungi is called as the Basidiomycota. The Basidiomycota are also called as the club fungi. Again, like the ascomycetes, they have septate hyphae, but what is different here is the sexual spores. Now if you look at this diagram, just notice this particular, focus on this particular area. Now this particular structure or the fruiting body here, it is called as the basidium. So at the, from the tip of the basidium, you have different spores which are coming out from this group of fungi, and these spores are called as the basidiospores. And please remember, asexual spores are not common. These basidiospores or the basidiomycetes are usually seen to decompose the wood. And whenever we describe of fungi, we say that their fungi has got two forms. One is called as the sexual form and another one is called as the asexual form. My friends, please remember, the sexual forms are also called as the teleomorph. Okay, sexual form is also called as the teleomorph, and the asexual form is called as the anamorph, A-N-A-M-O-R-P-H. So asexual form is called as the anamorph and the sexual form is called as the teleomorph. Easy to remember, anatomical morphology, that is your anamorph, that is your asexual form, and the sexual form is called as the teleomorph. So Cryptococcus species is one of the important examples of the basidiomycetes fungi. Now Cryptococcus exists as the asexual form in the yeast phase. It is called Cryptococcus neoformans, and in the sexual stage, the name is called for Cryptococcus is Phyllobasidiella neoformans. Okay, so that's why I specifically mentioned that sexual form of Cryptococcus species is a better example of a basidiomycetes fungi. So now we have finished the spore classification of the fungi. So we have learnt till now the morphological and spore classification of the fungi. Now we come to the clinical classification, one that is most important to us as doctors. So clinically, fungi are classified as causing superficial and deep infections. Now the deep infections or the deep mycosis is further subclassified as subcutaneous mycosis and systemic mycosis. Now let us see each of these different classes in a very brief overview. So superficial mycosis are further subclassified as surface infections and the skin infections or the cutaneous infections. Now the common surface infections are Tinea versicolor, Tinea nigra and Pedra, and your cutaneous infections, the major chunk of them being caused by your dermatophytes, which are also called as the skin plants. Okay, derma, skin, phytes, plants. Now one thing which is the hallmark of superficial fungal infections, students please remember this, is that superficial mycosis usually elicit a negligible immune response. Okay, they do not cause immune response, and that is why most of the patients with superficial fungal infection usually approach the outpatient department due to cosmetic reasons. So the fungal lesions are usually in the form of a nodule or a macule or a or a pigment or some discoloration or some scaling, or some of the skin changes are only seen. So because it does not elicit immune response, they are not that much symptomatic, and most of the time this group of patients usually approach for cosmetic problems. And if they come to the doctors, it is well and good, but unfortunately there are a class of people who go to the cosmetology clinics, and the cosmetologists who are there in such clinics, if they are not qualified doctors, they usually do some chemical treatments, laser or some peeling or something like that, not knowing that it is a fungal infection, and they further exacerbate or aggravate the pre-existing skin lesions. Okay, so that is a practical point of superficial fungal infections. Then we have the subcutaneous fungal infections. Now The usual subcutaneous fungal infections are your mycetoma, sporotrichosis, and rhinosporidiosis. So the hallmark for subcutaneous fungal infection is that all of these infections follow a trivial trauma. It might be a small pinprick, it might be a small thorn prick, okay, or it may be a small laceration or abrasion that you might have developed. So this will progress to form a subcutaneous fungal infection. So always there will be a history of a small trivial trauma from all these patients. Okay, so that is the hallmark of subcutaneous fungal infections. Then we come to the systemic fungal infections. Usually these systemic fungal infections are caused by the dimorphic fungi. So most of the dimorphic fungi capable of existing both in yeast and mold forms cause the systemic fungal infection. Now another hallmark, or one hallmark of systemic fungal infections, is that usually these fungal infections have two sites of infection. You have a primary site of fungal infection, and this primary site will usually be the lungs, because most of these systemic fungal diseases are acquired by inhalation of these fungal spores. And from that primary site, they go and invade the secondary sites via the lymphatics or via the bloodstream. So this is a basic hallmark of the systemic fungal infections. Then we also have a group of opportunistic fungal infection. As the name itself suggests, that whenever there is a compromise in our immune response, or whenever our immune system is subjected to different treatments or long-term use of steroids, or even anti-cancer therapy, or whenever there is a malignancy, or in cases of uncontrolled diabetes, or in HIV infections, where there is an immunocompromised status in the host, we usually have some of the fungal infections which are seen commonly, and they are your Candida, your Aspergillus, and also Penicillium, which now again is called as Talaromyces. So hereafter I will be you will be reading, or you will be learning about Penicillium infections as Talaromyces infections in the future. So please keep this change in mind. And also you have the mucormycosis, which is a component of the zygomycotic infections caused by mucor and Rhizopus species. So now we